So it's a bit strange to give a lecture in honor of myself, so therefore I would give sort of an anti-lecture and discuss failed projects, which I think is, like, after all, not such a bad idea, because it's something that we talk to when we discuss between us, so, but it's something that we don't really highlight so much. And maybe we should, because after all, the ideas involved, maybe, I don't say it's the case with this one, but it may be interesting even if they don't work, right? I had announced, as somebody, as many people noted, the three-phase project. I decided that was a bit over-ambitious, so I will stick to one failure here. And it's about a problem I actually don't know so very much about, but it's a central problem in convex geometry. And, okay, so let me describe what it is. So it's about, So we have a convex body in Rn, and I normalize it so that it has volume 1. And then I look at the covariance matrix of that. So basically that's the, yeah, it's written there, Mij, is the integral, the scalar product of the coordinate psi I times psi j, and then I subtract the expected value of the coordinates. I might very well arrange things to start with in such a way that the barycenter of the convex body is 0, and then the last of the terms here would disappear. I would just have the integral of psi I times psi j. And the question is to estimate this. So the question is, the question I'm going to talk about is, does there exist a universal constant, not depending on anything, such that Lk, which is by definition the determinant of this covariance matrix, raised to the power 1 over twice the dimension, it's just the normalization, should be less than this constant? That's the question. So this is, the interest of this comes from apparently many different sides and analysis, and I don't know very much about it, and anyway I don't really want to spend time about it. But it is related to the problem of having a convex, if you have a convex body, can you find slices of that convex body that have, if the volume of the convex body is normalized to be 1, can you find a slice so that the volume of the slice is bounded from above by a universal constant or bounded from below by a universal constant? And via some reductions that I don't know so much about, it actually turns out apparently to be equivalent to this problem of dominating the determinant of the covariance matrix. Okay, so I decided to solve this problem without so much hope, really, because it's been open for a long time. But still, one can always try. And so the way I approached it then was by looking at this function phi x that I have there, which is the logarithmic Laplace transform of the uniform measure on k. So I take the integral over k with respect to the Lebesgue measure in this case, over k of e to the x times psi, and then I take the logarithm of that. Then I get a convex function. That's fairly well known, since I take an exponential function and I just take its average with respect to the positive. that's the observation on the next page, then. Now, it would be very good if... to But still, I can hope to get a better B, right?
Or by better theorem.
Yeah, I can hope to get a better theorem.
And yeah. As if the proposition says if there is a B, then that's
exactly. Exactly, but I only know it for B equals N plus 1. But, yeah, but exactly, that's the thing. One could hope that one can find a better B, and then one would get a better theorem. If, for instance, you can find, if you could see that B equal to 1 works, then the slicing problem would be solved, right?
Alas, that's not the case here, because I only have B equal to N plus 1, but still. So if we choose as our probability measure, the uniform distribution on the polar body, then we have this first inequality there by Jensen's inequality. So we can put the logarithm outside of everything, and then x times psi, if x lies in k, polar, psi lies in k, then this exponential there is the exponent is less than 1, so you will get that the whole thing will be smaller than 1. And on the other hand, if you integrate the logarithm of the Monchampere measure with respect to this, you can estimate it by taking the integral over everything. And then you will get the logarithm of 1 over the product of the volume of k with the polar body. Except that you don't really get that because you get actually the quotient. You get k, the volume of k divided by the polar body. But since I have normalized things so that the volume of k is equal to 1, it's not there is no difference. So I have this. And now it's the Mahler volume of k.
So doing the very first integral on this page, you are integrating over?
Over, new, now the probability measure would be over the polar of k.
But phi is still defined.
What?
Oh, phi is also defined.
Phi is defined on all of our m. Phi was the yes. Phi is defined on all of our. So I get that the integral of the logarithm of the Monchampere measure is smaller than logarithm of 1 over the Mahler volume. And then I use this observation before that I put those two things together there, and then I get the chain of inequalities that I have there. And I will get it. So I don't get exactly what I said because I have a factor of 2 here, but it doesn't matter so much. You could actually, changing the argument slightly, you could eliminate that. Or you could notice that, I mean, in this case, when b is equal to n plus 1, I won't have a b there. My b now is n plus 1. So, and if a is really 4, square root of 4 is 2, so cancel against that, and then you would have exactly n, the square root of n.
But the dimensional constants that are known for this estimate, like I guess from John's theorem, probably, what are.
There is a lot of work for that, and I will probably come to that on the next slide here.
So you assume that some convexity, right? Longer.
I assume now that phi b times phi plus the logarithm of Monchampere, that is my u, is convex.
Right. So if it's affine, then you get e equal.
Yes.
So, but then you. But you're hoping, you don't have counterexamples for it being independent of n, so you still have hopes for that.
Let me again come to that a little bit later. I don't know if I have any hope because I really have no intuition about it. But I will.
But the failure is not the counterexample to that part.
Well, the failure is that so far it just gives the square root of n here. I want it to be independent of n.
But
the square
root could still work.
Unlikely, but who knows? I can always hope. So you will get like this inequality, and this is known in this business by people that work on this problem. It's called the easy bound, not the easy bound. So it's not anything that's gonna make me famous. But it's not. it doesn't seem to be so easy. I mean, it uses some fact, but some standard fact for complex geometry. So,
so this is just from Jones' theorem, right? Or not?
This is what?
From Jones'
theorem? I've seen reference where it's proved, but he uses other theorems and a little bit more.
Okay.
But now, by now, the best constant is a power of log n. That's a fairly recent theorem of Klartag and Lehec. But the story is that Bourguin had n to the power 1/4 multiplied by a logarithm. Then Klartag removed the logarithm, so we got n to the power 1/4. And then I think the great breakthrough was by Chen just a year or two ago, who got it down to something like, say any power, any small power of n would do. And then Klartag and Lehec had a logarithm of n to the power 4 or something like that. So there's a lot of work.
Is Chen this probabilistic? Or
I don't know who there is. Or a few Chens in the world.
Was he a post? Maybe I heard about this. Was he a post?
I don't know. But anyway, the theorem is short. My theorem is short in a way that, in a sense, that I will explain now. But first I will prove the theorem. I will sketch the proof of the theorem because it has something to do with complex analysis. So I consider the Peyne-Wiener space of functions associated to the compact cake. So they are all functions that are entire functions on Cn that are Fourier Laplace transforms of functions in L2 on K. And I define that the norm of such an entire function is the L2 norm of the function f on k, which is just any L2 function on k. That's my definition of the norm. That's the space that occurs in the classical Peyne-Wiener theorem. Then, now, if you look at the complex version of the exponential, you take phi, you extend it to complex numbers by just taking phi of a real part of C, and that happens to be the very fine curve for this space. That's fairly easy to see because in order to get the Bergman curve, you want to estimate how big is a function h at a particular point, and you just use the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality basically in the definition there, and you will see rather quickly that this is actually the Bergman curve for this Peyne-Wiener space. And now Monchampere of phi. So the definition of phi is the logarithm of this. Replace d lambda there by some other probability measure on k. Mm-hmm. Preferably say that the support is exactly equal to k. Then I could have exactly the same argument, and I would get the same theorem that this log n a phi plus n plus 1 times phi is convex. Would be precisely the same argument. And in that case, actually, it turns out that the theorem is sharp, because I can find a probability measure on k such that you cannot do any better than n plus 1. So the example that shows this is that you take your k to be a simplex. You take k to be a simplex, and you take the measure to be equal point masses at all of the vertices. Then it turns out that your phi is basically the function that defines the Fubini study metric on projective space, and you will have the embedding that I talked about before will actually be the identity, and so you will have exactly n plus 1. So the question is, can you do better by using something more that you have another measure than that you have the big measure? Well, since the Kobayashi theorem is so general, it's hard to say how you can actually feed in something more, some other information. So you can ask them if you can find another proof of the theorem which is more explicit, and maybe you can see from there that if you have another measure, then it will be a little bit better. So I don't have very much time, but let me, I don't have so many slides either, but there is actually another proof of it. So another proof of the theorem which gives an explicit formula. And this, I like it because it looks a little bit like Robert's exercises. Determinantal processes, etc. So I'll have to do it very quickly, but let's try to do it anyway. So you take any, you define phi in the same way, but you take now an arbitrary probability measure. You write down the SCM again. I have the formula for that there. It looks pretty much like before. But now I don't have, I have to look at it not only at the origin, so I really need to keep the parts. Mu x will now be mu weighted by the exponential of x times psi. And then it looks like the Hessian of phi looks like the mu I j, that's the first term, and mu minus mu I times mu j, where these are the first order moments. So I want to compute the determinant of that matrix. And I do that by some elementary exercises. So first I enlarge the matrix to n plus 1 times n plus 1 matrix. So I should, maybe I should write it here. I have my matrix here. So this is my matrix for n that I really want. And then I put a 1 there. I put a mu I, mu 1, up to mu n, mu 1, up to mu n. So I get beautiful there, enlarged matrix. And then by some elementary finagling, I get that the determinant of the beautiful n is, no, sorry, it's not really n, what I have here is u I. That's what I have. So then I have that the determinant of that matrix is determinant of n as I had before. I leave that as an exercise, but I give you a hint that you use a row reduction. And then with that hint you should be able to do it. Now I have n functions defined on k. These are the coordinate functions psi I. And now I add one more function, psi 0, which is just 1. I call that function psi 0. And now I get a vector in n plus 1 space, psi 0, psi 1, psi n, a vector of function. So it's a vector valued function on k. So. psi over super j is the vector psi on the j's factor. So it's a little complicated because there are so many variables. But if you take this away, you can think of this, that you take, this is, here you have a probability measure, and it defines stochastic, to have n stochastic identically distributed and independent variable, vector values, variables, psi 1, psi 0 up to psi n, and you take the sum of those, and you look at the generated function for the sum of those. So it looks like the kind of thing that you deal with when you're looking at the central limit theorem, things like that. But now you're multiplying by a determinant instead. You would like to say something intelligent about the convexity of this, using this, if you know something more about mu. Let me just finish by saying one case when you can actually make the n plus 1 smaller, and you can get it down as small as you want. You can get it as small as you want. So if you forget about what I wrote, just look at the number 2 here. So the function phi, as I said, was a logarithmic Laplace transform of a measure. So you just forget about what I said before. You have a logarithmic Laplace transform of a measure mu on k. That's a convex function. Okay, so not all convex functions are logarithmic Laplace transforms, but all logarithmic Laplace transforms are convex functions. Okay, so I call them LLT. They behave a little bit like line bundles, I think, in a way, because you can sum to LLT